folks, Rick Barraby here with Mark Stark. We are here at episode 6, okay, and what agents do in times of when times are tough like this, okay? So first thing I want to talk about is prospecting. All the questions I'm getting, especially in my coaching, are what are you doing for prospecting? Should I be prospecting? And I always, whenever I hear that question, I always think, should I be breathing? Yes, you should be breathing. When it comes to your business, you need to, it's the only way to feed fuel to your business. Now, I know it's a very serious situation going on right now. We get it, and I'm sensitive to it too. I live with a nurse practitioner. I am very sensitive to what's going on right now, keeping, you know, follow the social distancing, washing your hands, keeping it clean. My hands are dry, crispy, I might say, from washing them so much. But you have to, you know, we're an essential business. You should be running your business at the same time, and your sphere is where it starts. So I want to talk about the five categories I always talk about, and then I want to mention, okay, what changes I would make to that type of prospecting right now. And I would say with your sphere, the number one thing is stay in touch with them. Like I interviewed Avi this morning, Avi Dangore. I would say you don't talk about real estate. You check in, see how things are going, all right? And it'll almost always segue into real estate because people are curious. Hey, is anything really going on right now? Yeah, there's stuff going on right now. So like Mark said on the last one, have your MLS stats. You know, Dan said in the last 7 days, 660 properties have gone under contract in Nevada. You should know what that is. In your market in California, you should know what that is. In your market in Arizona as well. But things are happening, banks are loaning. It hasn't stopped. Has it slowed a little bit? Of course. It'd be crazy enough. I mean, it's slowed a little bit, but it's not come to a screeching halt. Any thoughts about sphere, Mark?
Well, yeah, my advice on that is you should start, okay? When you make that call, I want you to start with an attitude of this. Learn one more thing about your sphere or past client that you don't know. You know, if you just move away from worrying about, you know, as Rick alluded to, I've got to get business out of this, that will happen naturally. But I want your mindset to be this. If I'm dealing with my SOI or past clients, my goal is I'm going to learn one more new thing about them that I don't know up to this date. Start with that premise and go from there.
Okay, great. Awesome. Okay, so the next group is your farm. I mean, there's so many things you can do. First off, I have like a two-pronged approach to that. If you have a current farm and you've been working them for at least a year or so, you're going to treat them pretty much like your sphere. I mean, you're going to call them, you're going to check in, see how things are going. I mean, I've got agents that are, if they're elderly, stopping by, dropping them stuff off. There's also in your area websites with people that need things that you could check in, check, make sure anybody on your farm is on there. There's so many things you could do with a farm that you're currently working. And I would recommend that you definitely, you do that. Check in, start how things are going, and see where it goes from there, if there's any help you can do. Now, if you don't have a farm, and you want to do farming activities, I would say pick a just listed or a just sold in your area, okay, and use it, one of our companies, okay, because people want to know what's going on. They really do. I would start my script with, I know times are a little crazy, but even in these times, property's still moving. As a matter of fact, in your neighborhood, a house just sold last week and didn't get into the script. So you want to preface it with acknowledging, because some people will give you, you'll get a hard time if you're not at least sympathetic to what's going on. I recommend that you start that way. Okay, what's going on? But there are still properties moving. I mean, no one's asking you to sit like a boat in the water and do nothing without a rudder, without an engine. No one's asking you to do that. Okay, they're asking you to follow certain guidelines and be smart. Any questions about a farm? Any thoughts about a farm, Mark?
Yeah, I would just say keep it hyper-local. I totally agree. People want information about where they live. You know what? Simply share that you specialize in that area. A lot of the clients or other people in the neighborhood like to get information from you about specifically what's going on in their hyper-local neighborhood, and you have no problem sharing it. And as Rick says, you have specific stats, okay, to share with them, not only about the overall market, but you got to have stats about their world, their hyper-local market. And if you share that and say, I don't mind, I can keep you up to date on this as often as you would like, go from that basis, and I think it is something that I agree 100%. People are going to want to know what's going on in their world.
Yeah, and I would say absolutely, they definitely want to know what's going on in their world, especially if things are still closing in their neighborhood. And they're going to ask you things like, are the prices going down? Remember our first episode, someone said, I heard that prices, this was 3 weeks ago, going down 30%. And it's amazing what you hear in Orange County, not so. As a matter of fact, they're still fighting over properties in Orange County. Okay, what we do know right now is that your contact per dial ratio, something that I kept track of my whole career, which was 12%. If I call 100 people, I'm going to talk to 12 of them. That has more than doubled now because we know more people are home. Even the people that are working, a lot of them are working out of their house. The roads and everything has really slowed down as far as travel goes. So you know your contact per dial ratio is going to be excellent. Now, when it comes to farming, don't go door knocking right now. Definitely, I wouldn't. It's just going to freak people out, okay? So definitely use the phone. And if you're somebody that needs to get good on the phone, now is the perfect time. Like Mark said, add something. Add something to your repertoire. The phone is something that all of us need to get better at.
Yeah, and you know what? I want you to have some empathy from, you know, think about this. If someone's sequestered in their house, they've been there a while, they may just want to have a conversation.
Right.
They may just need someone to talk to. You know, social distancing right now is extremely important, but that doesn't mean it doesn't have its frustrations that go along with it. So you know what? I just need someone to talk to. I've kind of been, you know, we think about families being sequestered together, and that has its own fun little issues. Okay, but separate from that, what about being sequestered where, you know what, it's just you. You don't have anyone living with you. You can have friends coming over and visit you. That phone call might be the best phone call that they've gotten, not only all day, but all month. So be open. Just be relaxed, and guess what? It's another human being, and be open to having a conversation about really anything.
Absolutely. All right, good. Next on my list is for sale by owners. People go, should I be calling for sale by owners? I actually have agents in my coaching telling me, well, I'm not going to call them now. Why not? As a matter of fact, if anything, they're not getting showings. They're not getting as many calls right now, and some of them absolutely have to sell. Okay? So in my FSBO process, what I teach in Success Series is a preview process. Where you call them, hi, this is Rick at Berkshire Hathaway. I see your home in the market for sale by owner. Good for you. I like to keep up with all the properties in my area, whether they're in MLS or for sale by owners. I'd love to stop, and that's where I'd stop. I wouldn't stop by. I would like to take a look at your marketing pictures is where I'd go next. Send me everything you have. Now, if they're not ready, they're going to stop you. But when you're talking to for sale by owners and you're asking to keep up with all the inventory in your area, you're basically calling to see if they're cooperating with real estate agents. If they're not, they're going to tell you, well, no, we're not cooperating with agents. Oh, you're not? Interesting. Well, what if I have a buyer willing to pay a price acceptable to you? What should I do? Well, no, we can talk about those. Well, that's why I'm calling. All right? So have fun with it. Be assumptive. When you're talking to for sale by owners and expireds, my next group, it's always better assume they're moving. Assume they want to help and get into conversation with them. So instead of walking through their property physically, I would virtually walk through. Send me all your pictures, let me do a little homework, and then I'm going to call you and we'll go through your home room by room, the backyard, just so I can get all the detailed information. Would that work for you? Now, if they're not ready, they're going to say no. If they say no, you say great, you wait 3 or 5 days, you call them again, you follow up, you give them other information to think about. When I'm dealing with FSBOs, I call it laying doubt droppings. I never tell them they can't do it, but I know the NAR stats, which are 94% of them all end up using an agent. The 6% that actually sell themselves sacrifice 11 to 13% of their equity doing that, and it takes about 60 days for them to fail before they interview an agent. So what I did is I used that 60 days to get in rapport and develop a relationship with them. So when it came time for them to sell, I was in first place, if not the only choice sometimes, if you use that time. So you got to start with them when they're brand new, and you got to follow up. Remember, the fortune's in the follow up, or as I like to call it, semi-stalker lead follow up. And I say that smiling because when you're new at it, that's what it feels like, but it's really just selling. Any thoughts about for sale by owners, Mark?
Well, the only thing that I would add, and I think, you know what, you nailed it. I would add this, is that if they do ask you, well, let me ask you, do you have a buyer for my house? You know, I don't know yet. I haven't seen the house yet. But based on the circumstances, as Rick mentioned, send me the pictures that you're using to advertise the property. Two things I'll do. One, it will give me an opportunity to at least see the house and get a better understanding if there is a purchaser that I'm working with or maybe someone in my office is working with. But secondly, let me help you from a standpoint of how the pictures look to me. And with your permission, I'll give you some feedback that can help you, okay? Because I know how the marketing works and I know how buyers think. And so I'll give you feedback along those lines. And hopefully that will be of help, as well as familiarize myself with the property. So something along those lines. And then lastly, listen, this for sale by owners are a relationship opportunity. So as you start doing that and get into that conversation, you're having an opportunity to build that relationship, just like Rick said. And when they are ready, guess what? Hopefully, you're top of their list.
Yeah, so you never really tell them they can't, because I've never mentioned those stats to a for sale by owner, what they actually are with NAR. I just want to know them for myself because I know I'm not wasting my time. A lot of people think they're wasting their time. A lot of agents think they're wasting their time. So for sale by owners are nowhere near, because I've always... Ever since I've been in the business, I've always found this interesting, okay? If I'm working a farm, and Las Vegas, Arizona, all three markets are tremendous areas to work farm, but the best of farms are about 9% turnover rate, which means if I'm calling 1,000 homes, 90 of them are going to sell in the next year. So I'm calling 1,000 looking for 90 doing this. Yep, it's me. You got me. With for sale by owners and expires, they're all doing this. Yep, you got me. Right? So it's kind of like going right to the source. So that's why I've always... found it interesting that if the MLS put in the MLS, here's your hot leads for the day, everybody would call them. As soon as we call them expireds, very few people do. Okay, which goes into the next group, Mark, is that's expired listings, okay? To me, I mean, that's where the gold is, I think, you know? Expired listings are, they were on the market. First off, as an agent, I think it's the worst thing you can do to a seller is let their property expire, especially in today's market, with the average days being excellent, property values going up. I know we're on pause, slight pause right now, but not total pause. Okay, values. So my point is that when you do that to a seller, it's the worst thing you can do to them. So when people say, well, I'm calling other people's listings. No, you're not. You're calling somebody else's mistake. That's something that should never happen to a seller. And as an agent calling to solve the problem, I think it gives me a lot of juice, a lot of energy to call them because I know I'm calling to help. So that's always number one. You're calling to be of service. Now, I'm sure you too, Mark, you've been in this business the same time as me. When I first started calling them in my market, I was one of the first people to do it, and people did not like that. Other agents I'm talking about, sellers did, but other people did. So you gotta get into the right mindset. You're calling to help, you're calling to be of service to these sellers, okay? Now, in today's market, what's going on right now, I would start with the same way. I know things are crazy right now, but properties are still moving. I'm sure you figured out your listing came up last night as an expired listing. I was calling to see and just get into the script with them when you plan on interviewing agents virtually or and so forth. So get into the script with them, recognize what's going on, okay? Because I'm gonna tell you, the ones that have to sell are gonna be very impressed you're doing it. Some people will be indifferent and want to wait because their motivation isn't as such. But by you, you're either gonna get an appointment virtually, because remember, it's been listed. You have all the pictures, you have all the information. Right, you can do the appointment. Go back and listen to Dan's, the one I did with Dan last week on my YouTube channel. He explains how to do it virtually very well. Okay, so most of it you can handle over the phone with them. Plus, it'll give you, for a lot of you that aren't good on the phone, it'll give you a new confidence of trying it that way because you really don't have a lot of options right now. Okay, Mark, any thought? Tell them about how you used to call expires. I like that theory.
Well, you know what, and in this type of environment, it works really well, is I've always believed to get people talking about themselves and their home. So the first thing I would do is I wouldn't really talk about them being expired or not. The reality of it is, in my mind, they want to sell. So I would immediately call and ask them to tell me about their house. You know, can you tell me about how your backyard is landscaped or set up? Can you tell me about your kitchen area? Can you tell me about, would you consider it an open floor plan or more parcel? Give me information. And I would ask 3 or 4 questions about the house. All right. And they would sometimes stop me, in fact, many times, and say, well, why do you need to know this? Do you have a buyer? Oh, I don't know yet. I haven't seen the house. But based on what's going on now, do you have pictures? Okay, that you can send me, that I can view the house. And you know what? Based on their property coming off the market, you could say, you know what? I can't access it. All right, it's come off the market. If you could send those to me, that would be great. And let me look. And I would always ask them this question. After it comes out that their property didn't sell, say, can I ask you just your opinion? You've been involved with this. Why do you feel the property hasn't sold? I want to know that information from them. Why do you feel it didn't sell? Well, all they cared about is price. All they were worrying about was price. They just kept beating me up on whatever. Or you want to know something? You'll hear this. This is not a crazy statement. They'll say, well, I think we're priced too high. I think we're priced too high. You know what? Really? Yeah. I think, you know, my agent, I think if they would have lowered the price on this, we could have got it sold quicker. Don't assume anything. You don't know.
Yeah.
That's why expireds, a new agent comes in there, lowers the price, and it sells. A lot of those, and I worked a lot of expireds, is they never even were asked to lower the price. Because guess what? The other agent was nervous, didn't want to ask them to lower the price. That's an uncomfortable conversation. So they never asked, when really the client's like, okay, but I'll lower the price if it'll get the job done. So again, assume nothing.
Yeah, I call that, you know, what's been shocking to me always is that I call it owning the price. A lot of agents, once they tell them a price, they own the price.
Yeah, so true.
So then their ego won't allow them to say, you know what, I tried to get you too much for your house and it's overpriced now. So it's amazing how that can happen, but it should never happen. When you're doing a presentation at someone's home, the best way to present a CMA is to show them the homes and say, okay, do you know where this house is? All right, how many bedrooms? I make them answer me. Like I highlight the CMA, so they have to answer 3 bedrooms, 2 baths. So as I'm going through the comps, they're experiencing it, okay? And in today's market, especially in Arizona, California, I mean, you guys, it's kind of simple to do a CMA because a lot of homes are you have model matches and so forth. So it's always better. And then when you price the home, you always say, in today's market, snapshot in time, this is what the home appears, where it puts it. Well, we're going to know quickly because the market will speak to us quickly as to whether the price is wrong or right. Okay, so never own the, it's not your price, okay? It's the market's price. And let them pick it, if possible, by walking through the CMA that way. All right, cool. Next group is social media. Hey, we were a little uncomfortable 3 weeks ago starting this. I don't know about you, but it's pretty comfortable now doing these Facebook Lives. So this is something new that we've added to social media, is doing these Facebook Lives because we're not traveling, we're not doing events, not at least not live, okay, which is kind of interesting doing them like this. Like I'm doing
back
success
off.
Series.
You moved a little closer.
I know, sorry.
Okay, back off.
Why could you feel my breath?
So yeah, anyway. Exactly. When your voice gets a little louder, I know you're moving up.
Yeah.
Just wait.
Or, never mind. Okay, so next week I'm doing success series and I'm gonna do it on Zoom if you need your CE credits in Nevada, and it'll be on Google Hangouts for everybody else. Okay, so social media, I would just say, most of you that I talk to at least, you have an idea of what you want to do on social media. You just haven't done it yet. So I would say, start doing that thought. I've seen so many creative things, from workouts to just people like talking about what's going on. I just saw one with Patrick Clark, one of our agents he's a dynamite violin player. He did he plays I'm going to practice. You can decide whether you want to listen. I love that. And he just played for a while. That was great. I've even done a couple crazy music videos. Whatever. Have fun with it. Let people know that you're a professional. You do real estate. You also have a life. You're interesting. Everybody has a hobby or things that they do. You know, I'm going to tell you, you're looking at one of the biggest holdouts on social media up until I started this job almost 6 years ago. I didn't even have a Facebook page. Paul helped me start mine. Okay? I didn't even have a Facebook page. And now I have a Facebook page, I have Instagram, I have followers, I have LinkedIn, I have all that stuff. I have a podcast, all of that stuff since I've started this job because they work, okay? And the toughest part was involving in adding my personal life into the equation, okay? I'm telling you, when they can relate to you, they want to use you. And I could go down the list of agents we have that have opened it up to that. Avi, Billy, I mean, there's a whole bunch of them now that have really opened it up to that. I see them everywhere, a whole bunch of agents. So I would say, when it comes to social media, decide what platforms. To me, because I'm 55, I'm not an Instagram demographic person, you know. So I have an Instagram account, but it's not my most used. My most used is Facebook, LinkedIn. Okay, I have Instagram and I have Twitter, but those are the four that I use. And I also, as agents, you can have your own podcast too. It looks really good, and you'd be surprised how many people listen to it. I'm shocked how many people listen to mine. And you don't have to do one a week. You could do one a month. You could do 5 a year. It doesn't really matter. People will listen to you. Video is amazing, and audio, how well it works when they can just get to know you. Mark, any thoughts about that?
Yeah, okay, I'm going to share an idea that I know some of you are already doing. I love it, and I think it goes right down this powerful aspect of social media, and it takes into account what everyone is dealing with, and that is having some of these Zoom parties. All right, you know, you can invite, it works for everyone. It works for your sphere, it works for past clients, it even works for a neighborhood that you're working in a geographical farm. Say, listen, here's what we do. Don't know if you're interested, but every Friday we get together and we have a wine party, okay? And you don't have to come, but you're more than welcome to. Would love you to join in with us. It's just a bunch of people from the neighborhood as well as people who I know personally. And you know what? You get to interact with people and it's a lot of fun. Would love to have you join us. And you know, you'd be amazed of how many people will go, you know what? Sounds fun. And if they don't, that's okay too. But it's just the invitation. And you can do all kinds of different ideas. You can have ideas of, you know, things with pets, okay, where you talk about your own pets and you're all visual, you know, videoing it. Whatever the case may be is, I would start thinking about social media parties. And to Rick's point, you know, what floats your boat? What are you into? What excites you that it will be truly fun for you and you'll be passionate about presenting it? So you're not just doing it for someone else, you're doing it for yourself and you're inviting people to participate. So that would be my social media idea. It wasn't my idea. I got it from a lot of sales executives that you guys are already doing these types of parties and they're great ideas.
Yeah, because it's the closest thing you can get to being social right now is having those parties. And a lot of people are doing them. It looks great too. All right. Any final thoughts?
No, hopefully we shared some great little tips on this session that you can continue to utilize, moving your business forward and your life forward. Anything else, Rick?
Yeah, I would just say, don't stop. I mean, you can slow down a little. Some of you, you know who I really am impressed by? You people that are homeschooling at the same time. Wow, that's amazing. You got your kids at home and you're working and you got things going on. It's really showing some of you, I think, how efficient and effective you can be. But keep rocking it. Don't stop. Do the best you can in these crazy times, and hopefully we're out of the woods very shortly.
Yeah. Any questions?
Oh.
We had some great comments. Thank you, everyone, for making your comments. This is Sarah and Diane.
I know this morning.
Kevin Child said, getting in relationships, remember Ford, ask them about their family, occupation, yep. Recreation, dream.
Very true.
Thank you, Kevin.
Ford concept.
Donna Belgram said, we love these. We should keep them up in the new world.
You know what? That talks about setting up the new normal. And I promise you, okay, the new normal is here to stay. So we want to take all the great ideas and getting your feedback, all right, is what's going to tell us is going to go on forever. And that doesn't mean we're not going to use some of the past success that works and some of the new. So thank you.
And by the way, great job, Donna, on the podcast yesterday.
Vicki Dawson said she had 3 new listings this weekend.
Nice.
Yeah. Woohoo!
Way to go, Vicki.
Go, Vicki.
We love new listings, by the way.
Lisa Grumet said, I put a house on the market last Thursday in OC and opened escrow yesterday morning. Buyers are out there.
They are.
Kim Nathanson, what do you think about dropping off Pop Boys?
You know, my personal opinion is right now, as a respect to individual people that don't know and have not pre-agreed for me to stop by, I wouldn't stop by. But I'll tell you, mailing, okay, something to somebody, to an area to say, hey, this is something for this neighborhood and I thought everyone would enjoy this, and mailing it to them, I think is a great opportunity. I just want to be very respectful. It's one thing if we're working with a client and they know and requested for us to do something and we're working together on it, that's awesome. We still use common sense and we do it, but I wouldn't approach them. Same reason why, and this is again, is coming from a door knocker, I would not door knock in this environment. I would use these innovative ways to connect.
Jenny Manusi, I have been holding online happy hours. They work well.
Wow, I like that.
Any type of happy hour can work.
Yeah.
Okay.
As long as you're happy.
Daniel Trevino got 2 escrows this week.
Woohoo!
Nice. Yeah.
Nice.
Ryan Brightwell is a new dad, by the way.
Congratulations, yes. Ryan, yes.
Woo! Great info. Thanks for the effort. Appreciate it.
Vicki Dawson, always inspiring and a fresh perspective.
Cool.
Yeah. I think she was talking about me.
Of course.
Mary Clope, are we supposed to be having wine parties with social separation?
Wine party isn't where you get together and wine and complain.
Correct.
It's where we're all drinking wine and talking at the same
time. Exactly. Hey, you can even have a sweet party. Have a bake-out party to say, everyone bake a cake, and this is what we're all trying it. Do, again, what you're passionate about and what you enjoy, and guess what? You'll attract different people, especially if you did a good job communicating together and asking good questions and listening. You'll find out, oh my God, he or she is a baker. They enjoy that kind of stuff. What a great idea. Why don't I have something to do with baking? And I know they'd want to be involved because they're already into it. That's the importance of asking insightful questions and listening.
Matt Marino, and I believe he was talking about this when you were talking about FSBOs, have them sell you on their house and why it should be for sale.
That's true.
It's a great question.
Tell me why I should show your house.
Nisreen Diop said you can do a virtual pop-by with e-gift cards.
There you go. Love that.
Virtual pop-by. I like that.
Love that.
Does that mean I get to use my emoji? I like my emoji.
All right, one more.
This one, I don't know who this is for, but Sashi Sharma said maybe a haircut party.
A haircut party.
Apparently it wasn't me.
clearly I'll need one quite soon. We'll see how it goes.
I call this the Gillette do.
All right. Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Appreciate it.